I'm Nisar Ahmed and welcome to my YouTube-based e-learning platform. Today I will talk about reservoir geophysics. This is the short outline for this talk. First, I will discuss what is reservoir geophysics, how we can define it, then the concept of seismic alchemy, reservoir versus exploration geophysics, and then how different tools can be used in reservoir geophysics and how reservoir geophysics provides advantages over exploration geophysics. One more thing about today's e-lecture, that it will be a bit more descriptive. So here we go. First, what is reservoir geophysics? It can be defined as application of geophysical techniques within a non-hydrocarbon reservoir, or another way to define it, it provides essential information about quantity and quality of the reservoirs that is key to reducing risk and improving productivity when drilling wells. Reservoir geophysics means going beyond the structural geology or interpreting seismic sections to get geological image of the subsurface. It simply means in reservoir geophysics, we are not talking about the structural interpretation of seismic data. Or we can say another way, the scope of reservoir geophysics is beyond the exploration geophysics, where mostly seismic data is interpreted to find the possible hydrocarbon traps. Reservoir versus exploration geophysics. The concept of petroleum reservoir geophysics is relatively new as compared to exploration geophysics. The first point is, in the past, the role of geophysics was largely confined to exploration, and the whole target of geophysicists was picking and tracking laterally consistent seismic horizons for the purpose of mapping geological structures, stratigraphy, and reservoir architecture. And to a lesser degree, or less attention was paid on the development of discoveries. As the second point is about cost efficiency has taken over as a driving force in the economics of oil and gas industry, and as major assets are near depletion, geophysics has increasingly been recognized as a tool for improving the bottom line closer to the wellhead. The third point, the reliability of geophysical surveys, particularly seismic, has greatly reduced the risk associated with drilling wells in existing fields. This figure here is a good representation of seismic alchemy. Seismic alchemy means seismic application as a function of time. We can see how seismic techniques have been evolved with the passage of time. Alchemy can also be defined as the seemingly miraculous change of a things into something better is called alchemy. So this figure describes how seismic evolves from subsurface structural interpretation to the rock physics or seismic petrophysics. Many good examples of seismic alchemy, these are imaging beneath salt, and other is Ville time equation, in which the authors noted that the use of gas velocities in the equation is not valid, but unfortunately people from industry and academia are continuously making mistake by using this equation for partial saturation cases or for fully saturated gas case. Similarly, the realization of the importance of bright spot on true amplitude sections in 1970s was perhaps industry's first realization that we could look beyond the structure in the data. The quality of pre-stake data continually improved for AVO and has become household term. In the next phase, the term seismic lithology has been used to describe inversion of seismic data for impedance. And AVO has become practical for lithology signatures since 1970s, and this paper addressed this issue very clearly. Many other examples can also be given for seismic alchemy, and it is continuing to evolve. Rock physics, seismic petrophysics here is another tool. There are several specific differences between exploration geophysics and reservoir geophysics. These differences are based on the assumption that that well control is available within the area for the geophysical survey. So, and the second is some understanding of rock physics is also available for interpretation. The third one is a careful designed geophysical survey can be conducted at a level of detail that will be useful. Then 3D seismic or other geophysical data can be collected. And the next one is geostatistical techniques, and then ultra thin bed or focused approach, and then borehole geophysics or passive seismic monitoring. I will discuss each point in a short and precise way to describe its application for reservoir geophysics. The first one is well control. The first point, well control is very important. Even in exploration geophysics, the local calibration of the geophysical response become poor, and we often require extrapolating well data from far outside the area of interest. In the second point, in reservoir geophysics, it can often be assumed that a reservoir is already under production or at a late stage of development. Therefore, wells are available for the analysis and providing a variety of information. So, the reservoir geophysicist has an advantage, and because all this information is available for a reservoir geophysicist, like this information include interpreted well logs data, then he might have description of lithology, including the mineralogy, porosity, and perhaps even the morphology of the pore shape, pore spaces. Then he has information of fluid content because the well has already been drilled in this area, and many well logging tools have been run in this well. So a lot of information is available for geophysical studies. Well control mean the detailed depth constraints for geological horizons are available. Exploration-based seismic data limited to estimate of time to depth conversion data that are inaccurate without well ties. Possibly estimates of the proximity to the boundaries, aquifers, and other features of interest if the well has been tested. The next point is good estimate of the total volume of reservoir if the reservoir has been under production. Then usually additional information concerning the in situ conditions of the reservoir, including the formation temperature, pressure, and properties of the oil and gas and brine are also available. The ESSA team can relate these observations to the geological interpretation and thereby determine the need of seismic survey at increased resolution. Similarly, the geophysicist should also be familiar with the usefulness and limitation of petrophysical and reservoir engineering studies, and should be able to ask intelligent questions to the expert in those fields. The next point is about rock physics control. One of the major questions a geophysicist is asked, or he should ask independently, is the is this will the geophysical techniques being proposed be able to differentiate between competing reservoir models sufficiently well? The answer of this question does not lie in geophysical modeling, but it lies in rock physics or seismic petrophysics. The presence of wells and possibility that If some core samples are also available, it greatly improves the capability of reservoir geophysicists to address this question. The question I asked at the start of this slide. Similarly, if we have this log information, both P and S wave logs, and then density log and image log that provides the information about fractures, we can use it carefully to provide basic seismic properties, which in turn are modeled for varying lithological character, fluid content, and in situ conditions such as pore pressure. The geophysicists must always be careful about the misuse of input seismic data and concerned with scaling properties, particularly the possibility that physical effects observed at one scale. Just like we, if I give you an example of seismic attenuation and dispersion, and we know there are three scales. One is mesoscopic, microscopic, and macroscopic. So suppose there is a model for skirt flow and we can't use it for low frequency or for mesoscopic scale. So we must be very careful when we are using any rock physics model for reservoir studies. Similarly, the last point is sometimes a little knowledge can be dangerous weapon. It means if we don't have all the information we require to implement a reservoir rock physics model to a reservoir rock, we must be careful. If we don't have a complete description knowledge of reservoir rock, it might be useful. It might not be useful or dangerous to use then rock physics studies to understand a reservoir rock. The next tool is survey design. The design of a seismic survey for reservoir purposes can often be optimized for specific interpretation goal. If the goal of the survey is to define the structural limits of the field, then a 3D seismic survey can be designed with that in mind. And if the goal of the survey is to define the extent of a gas zone, the geophysicist may be able to use log data, seismic petrophysical modeling, or old seismic data to determine whether the certain offset range is required to differentiate between water and gas zones. And we know AVO can be used to differentiate between gas and water zones. Similarly, the third point, if the objective is to get highly accurate belt ties or wavelet phase control are needed, an appropriate placed vertical seismic profile may be designed. Similarly, if an acquisition footprints had been observed in a previously acquired seismic data set, and that footprint obscured the attributes used to define the reservoir targets, the geophysicist can design the new survey to eliminate the troublesome artifacts. In short, the fact that the target is well known permits the reservoir geophysics survey to be designed in a more enlightened manner than our typical exploration survey. The next tool is 3D seismic survey. Most of the reservoir geophysics is based on high fold 3D reflection seismic data with vertical receivers. But in particular, in order to image below the gas clouds here that obscure P wave imaging of reservoir, converted waves are being used, or multi-component seismic data is being used for this purpose. In the figure here, we can see the P wave seismic rays scattering because of velocity inhomogeneity caused by the pocket of gas results in an inability to image through the gas clouds. Just like this is our reservoir zone, and here is a gas cloud or gas pockets, and P wave velocity has been scattered here, and we are unable to image this zone by using P wave seismic data or compressional seismic data. So in that case, we may use multi-component UFOs to record the S wave, as well as because the fluid content has little effect on velocity of S wave, and this ray is not scattered, and the reservoir can be imaged using a multi-component receivers, as shown here in this figure. Another application of sea survey or multi-component recording is shown here. The fractures play an important role in many reservoir development schemes and has led to a number of experimental programs for multi-component source and receivers. These studies make use of the fact that shear waves polarized in direction parallel to the fracture. Fractures travel faster than those polarized perpendicular to the fractures. We can see here in this figure, here the shear wave is traveling just perpendicular to the fractures, while in this direction, shear wave is traveling parallel to the fractures. And we know the shear wave travels faster when it travels parallel to the fracture. So that's why shear wave behavior can be used to identify the fractures that play an important role in many reservoir development schemes. It means if we are also conducting or recording S wave along with P wave, then it provides some extra information that sometimes P wave fail to provide us. The next tool is seismic attribute. Attribute is a wide term, and when we are saying that seismic attribute, it means any information of our interest that can be derived from seismic data. So seismic attributes are the additional features that can be used in both exploration and reservoir geophysics. Over 200 seismic attributes are in use in some geophysical processing or interpretation software packages. The most common is the seismic amplitude, and it is very helpful attribute, especially to discriminate between fluid and lithology, and sometimes it provides the information of porosity. Most of the original seismic attributes were based on Hilbert transform and consist of instantaneous amplitude that is also known as the amplitude of wave envelope, and then instantaneous phase, most useful for accurate time picking, then instantaneous frequency, probably most oftenly used with thin bed reverberations, and then coherence and depth and depend azimuth. So a lot of attributes are present, and these attributes can be used both in exploration and reservoir geophysics studies. However, care must be taken when we are applying seismic attributes, especially in the thin bed areas, because in the thin bed areas, we might face two troublesomes. One is about the resolution of seismic data, as the high frequencies are absorbed, and secondly, due to scattering of a seismic wave in thin layers, maybe we can face a seismic dispersion. The next point is the well calibration. Reservoir geophysicists make careful use of so many available attributes calibration at wellbore using log data, core data, and boreholes seismic information available in order to test the correlation of attributes with rock properties. Again, the reservoir geophysicist enjoys here significant advantage over the exploration geophysics. The question is how. Actually, the exploration geophysicist cannot always tie the seismic data and its character attribute to the properties of the formation as evidenced from the well data. It is important that the reservoir geophysicists make use of all the information and expertise available within the asset team to provide the tightest possible calibration. Otherwise, the advantage of performing reservoir geophysical studies is lost. So, and the next tool and a very important tool is geostatistics. Earth science data exhibit spatial connectivity to greater or lesser degree. As the distance between two data points increases, the similarity between the two measurements decreases. So, geostatistics is rapidly evolving branch of applied statistics and mathematics that offers a collection of tools for understanding and modeling the spatial variability. Spatial variability includes scales of connectivity, heterogeneity, and directionality within two data sets. So, geostatistical methods allow us to quantify and assess the reliability of models we generate. Just as an example of multi-scale modeling of a reservoir rock has been shown here. In short, geostatistics provide us when we are going to make a static or dynamic model of a reservoir rock, and geostatistics provides us our tool to quantify the uncertainty when we are making a model by using different points that are located far from each other. Now, the next point is focused approach. We already know the reservoir geophysicist already has a lot of information as compared to exploration geophysicist. Like, he can be used calibrated seismic data to wells, investigated the seismic petrophysical response for various scenarios. There is an opportunity since he has a lot of data. So there is an opportunity to collect new data and only the data which will be required to observe the feature of interest. For example, I will give an example. He or she could collect, say, only four offset seismic data if one were convinced that the four offset contained all the information that was essential to study. We know, suppose four offset seismic data provides the information about fluids or lithology, and then up to which maximum limit we need to acquire the data. So by using some initial data that is already available, we can use more focused approach to what type of data is of our interest and how we can acquire it. When it comes to the next point is borehole geophysics. When it comes to reservoir geophysics, all these tools that are listed here provides extra and more detailed information about reservoir. That's why we can say reservoir geophysics has advantage to record the data from the below the noisy or weathered zone. Initially, the objective of all these tools was to tie between surface seismic data and well observations, but they have been extended beyond that in many cases. Just like if I give an example of VSP method, it provides a lot of additional information, like it provides better vertical and spatial resolution, provides to estimate quality factors, locate the small faults and thin layers around the wellbore, improve processing for surface seismic, or it can be used to identify the overpressure zones. Similarly, if I am talking about, say, sonic lag, we can now record even shear wave log along with P wave, as well as density log, and shear wave log can be further used for fluid substitution modeling. I have already recorded and uploaded reasonably detailed lecture on well seismic or borehole geophysics already, and these lectures are present on my YouTube channel. Just search geophysics and advanced seismic e-learning. This is the name of my channel on YouTube, and you will find the series of lectures on well seismic or borehole geophysical methods. This is the last tool that I will discuss in this presentation. The first, we will define what is passive seismic. It is a new revolutionary geophysical exploration technique that uses natural microseismicity as the seismic source, like micro earthquake with magnitude up to 1 to 2 on Richter scale, and these occur almost everywhere. So a portable and specially designed network of seismometers are deployed on the surface and set to record continuously for a period of few months in order to detect a sufficient spatial distribution of local micro earthquakes. See the figure here. Just like we can see, this is earthquake source here, and our stations are deployed on the surface, and we are continuously recording these seismic waves in the form of P and S waves on the surface that are coming from this micro earthquake source. Earthquake monitoring has become more precise and accurate even at low level of seismicity. The question arises why I'm saying here it has become more precise and accurate. The answer is very simple. It is due to the placement of geophones downhaul. Even here, like our stations are on the surface, recording stations, but in another case, we can also place these stations in the borehole, away from the surface noise and closer to the source of seismic energy. The second point is passive seismic monitoring of micro earthquakes induced during oil field operations is a quickly growing technology for mapping the fractures. That's why the mechanical response of reservoir host rocks has become studied in some detail in the recent times. The third point is about deformation. Deformation of the reservoir host rock has become a subject of great interest. An example of Ekofisk platform in the North Sea. Significant seismic deformation is induced during hydraulic fracture simulation, like during injection wells, or to enhance the permeability in tight gas reservoirs, or even during a production case. So passive seismic monitoring during hydraulic fracturing have led to improved reservoir development in number of cases. These micro seismics can be directly used to characterize the resulting fracture network and improve the stimulation design. This is just one example that how passive seismic monitoring results help to find the fractures, to find the fracture locations in a cross-sectional view of seismicity and intervals of gas production. This figure is also showing the location of earthquake source and the position of geophones at different depths. The position of geophone at different depths and micro fractures in the rocks. So many more examples can be found in the literature. In short, passive seismic monitoring is a great tool in reservoir geophysics studies. It provides a lot of information, including deformation monitoring for reservoir management and optimization, monitoring of fluid leakage for environmental and economic consideration. It provides additional time-lapse constraints for reservoir simulation. For more detail, have a look on reference paper mentioned here. A major part of this presentation has been taken from this paper, Reservoir Geophysics. So this is the end of this video, and thanks for watching. If you want to see more helpful videos in future, please subscribe the channel. That way you will get update and notifications anytime new content comes out. All right, well, that's all I have for you today. If this video helped you, please give it a thumbs up. We hope to see you again with more helpful videos in future. Take care. बाय बाय।